And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Historical, historical day. Yep, we got her. We have Sophia Stewart. She is the writer and owner of the Matrix and Terminator movies, games, and derivatives. She's affectionately known by her fans as the mother of the Matrix. On September 25th, 2014, in Utah federal courts, Stewart's book, script, and treatment called The Third Eye, under copyrights 81, 83, and 84, was validated by two federal judges, Evelyn First and Dee Benson. And we are here with Sophia Stewart for the first time to set the record straight and give the truth to the people and to the family. Welcome, Sophia Stewart.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Philip, for having me on your show today.
Absolutely. So let's get started and dig right in. Well, before we dig in, let's do this. Let's go back a little bit before that and talk about, a little bit about your career and life. You've been writing since your childhood. Walk us through a little bit of that in terms of, you know, where did you get this impetus to write so creatively?
Well, for one thing, I want people to know that I'm a prodigy, so things are very easy for me to do effortlessly, you know, but like Venus and Serena, starting out in elementary school, learning tennis, and of course, Tiger Woods at 3 years old, I started writing in the seventh grade. And one of my teachers, mentor and teachers, was a college professor who taught writing at the college level. And one of my teachers got sick and he substituted and he told us, well, she was an English teacher. And he said, well, you know, I don't know very much about the English, but I do know about writing and I can teach you guys how to write. So I was already a prolific writer from elementary. I didn't do any high school. I took the New York Regents and went into college. And I had some very prolific master writers in college. Max Segal, former journalist with the New York Times. Emile Capouya, an author, essayist, critic. Big Apple playwright Paul Cherry, and of course at USC, I went to USC graduate school. USC is one of the most predominant, you know, outstanding film schools in the country. You know, the Trojans, USC Trojan, you know, the University of Southern California. I went there, graduate level, and one of my teachers, Leon Roth, R-O-T-H, his son is the screenwriter, Eric Roth, that won the Oscar for Airport 70.
Okay, we lost you there, Sophia. We lost your video. Let's see if we can get, there you go. Your video is back now. Okay, go ahead.
You know, what happened was a call came through.
Oh, no problem.
I should have just downloaded this on my Apple. I have an Apple iPad.
Yeah. You're on your phone right now, so that's kind of cool.
iPad, you know, but I can take calls and do calls. But anyway, like I was saying, Leon Roth is the Oscar Award screenwriter for Airport 79, and he also did Benjamin Button and Forrest Gump. Mm. So his dad was, of course, one of my mentors while I was at USC. I went to film school with my classmates, those former pro football players, Marcus Allen, Dennis Johnson, Ronnie Lott, August Curley, James Sinclair, and the Moore brothers, and others, of course. And Charles White, the Heisman winner, was leaving when I was coming in. And so Marcus and Ronnie and those guys introduced me to him. So this is my background. I already worked for television back in 78 and 79, with an Oscar Award producer, Perry Miller Adato, Channel 13 out of New York City, because I'm a New Yorker. Mm-hmm. And I was working for the studios when I wrote the Third Eye Matrix script and book. I was at USC.
Wow, what year was this?
Yeah, and I worked for Columbia Pictures, the studios.
What year was that?
It was 1980.
Wow, okay.
So while I was at USC, that's when I wrote The Third Eye, Matrix, and Terminator. The third eye, meaning because we have two eyes on Earth, but there's another eye, the most powerful, all-seeing eye of God. And Matrix, of course, is the woman's womb, mentioned five times in scripture, three times in Exodus, two times, of course, in Numbers. It's a 7,000-year-old word. And Matrix, Exodus 34th chapter, 19th verse, God says, he who opens up the matrix or open up the woman's womb, coming through the woman's womb, the baby, those are his children born with souls. So it's God's children versus man's children. Man's children, of course, is the artificial intelligence, the AI. In other words, when man goes into the lab, he creates test tube babies, petri dish babies, artificial inseminated babies, gender bender babies, you know, where they go in and manipulate the genders. These are all soulless beings because they don't come through the womb. They're not three-dimensional beings. They're like one-dimensional amoebas, just like the mule. The mule was not created by God. It was created by man. So it can't have a baby. It has no womb. It has no seed, no soul. So that's what Matrix and Terminator is all about. The Terminator is the prequels or the beginning of the work. In other words, Terminator End Time Revelations, the Terminators and on their own planet in the future is past, present, and future time travel. So the Terminator hears the Oracle's prophecy that a baby is going to be born that's going to destroy them in the future when they enslave mankind, which is a real true-to-life story that's going on right now.
Mm-hmm.
So the Terminator knows that the mother, Sarah Connor, because Sarah Connor is Neo's mother. Neo's just an anagram or a sneaky way of calling him the one. N-E-O-O-N-E, one and the same. So John Connor's J.C., Jesus Christ, grows up to be Neo, one and the same in the Matrix. So the Terminator, Terminator End Time Revelations, cracking the codes, the revelations, getting the knowledge, has to time travel to the past to kill Sarah Connor so she won't have the baby Neo. So the first three Terminators, that's what's going on. When you see the Terminator trying to kill the mother, then he's trying to kill the teenager, then he's trying to kill the man child, but he's on his way to the city, which is the Matrix in the future. And he's hidden there while the machines are looking here, there, everywhere, but he's right under their nose growing up. And when he reaches the age of 30 years old, that's when the rebellion, Reloaded Revolution, starts, the third movie, because he has to prepare to fight the machine. So the rebels come in, they find him, and they take him, of course, to Morpheus for training and to the Oracle for the prophecy. So this is why the two movies come together as one. And when you try to take him someplace else, like Osiris's body, it comes back together again as one.
Mm-hmm.
One epic story divided into two movies, franchises. Because what I wrote was a 283-page book on it. You know, the Third Eye Matrix, you see the actual original work. You see the characters, the graphics, the special effects. I'll be back. We'll be back. He comes back as three different cyborgs. You know, the T-1800 is a microchip clone, naked cyborg, naked without shame. He's without shame because he's soulless, seedless. He doesn't even know he's naked until someone tells him to put on some clothes.
Mm.
No one had ever seen anything like quantum physics, ancient sacred geometry, calculus jumping off of the screen.
Absolutely.
I scored a 98 on the IRS exam, and they wanted me to come and work for them. I took the New York Regents and got my high school diploma. You know, I didn't need to, and I could have taken my master's and bachelor's at the same time, got them all at once. Because I'm a polymathematician, just the same way like Tesla and Leonardo da Vinci. And people don't understand. understand polymaths are people who are creative. So when you see Tesla creating the electrical cars and Wi-Fi and all these frequencies and energy, well, in the Matrix, I have Matrix and Terminator, I have alien technology. In other words, when the aliens crashed at Roswell, home, that was back in the 40s, 47s, in the 50s before I was born. Homeland Security and the FBI have autographed copies of my book. So when they read the fourth installment of The Matrix, the fourth installment actually takes place right after Matrix 1. Matrix 1 has won 4 Oscars, and it has made billions of dollars around the world. In fact, and Terminator probably made more than $100 billion since 1984 to present right now.
Wow.
This is what has been so long in the truth coming out, because the government failed to protect my copyrights.
When did you find out that it had been stolen? Was it prior to, or was it when it was starting to have a promotional campaign?
I didn't know about the theft until I viewed The Matrix March the 31st, 1999.
Wow.
Went into the movie, I saw my work on the screen, and no one had bought the work, and it was already copyrighted 81, 83, and 84. So I'm being a paralegal, well-versed in law, criminal law, intellectual property law, trademark law, and tax laws, and a number of other civil law, federal procedure, all of that. I have a gift in law. So I called the legal department at Warner Brothers. This was April 1st, 1999. And of course, they offered me $5 million for the copyrights. Well, I already know how much my work is worth. It's worth billions of dollars. I've always known that. Because many people were like, well, why didn't you take the $5 million? Well, if I had taken the $5 million, I'd be on a talk show talking about how I sold the copyrights that were worth billions of dollars for $5
million. Mm-hmm.
You know, fans, they just see money and they just think of greed and they don't think of the consequences, you know, of their choices. Mm-hmm. But me, I know my work and I've dealt in numbers. I was doing taxes when I was 11 years old, getting paid like H&R Block before it even existed, because grown people didn't understand how to do taxes. That's why H&R Block became in for demand, because so many people don't even understand the mechanics of taxes.
Wow, so you're in the movie theater. I can only imagine what that's like. So March 3rd, 1999, you're in there watching this movie and you're like,
March
1st.
March
1st.
No, 31st. Yes.
March 31st.
Yeah, March the 31st is the national release of the movie, Matrix. Now, I didn't know anything about the Terminator until the FBI was investigating, and they told me in 2001. Because what happened was I turned the money down, which kind of blows people's minds. And I called up the U.S. Attorney's Office and asked them if they would prosecute the case, because I come from military law enforcement family. So I know the hierarchies of law, and I'm a paralegal.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I'm a prodigy, so I understand the whole process, the whole system. So I contacted the U.S. Attorney's Office, and of course they said they wanted to prosecute the case and told me to take the evidence over to the FBI, and the FBI would investigate, and then they would come and prosecute the case. But when that all happened, they got paid off, and they tried to get me to lie about the investigations, and I told them, no, I would not do that. I don't compromise. It's very important that truth comes out. It's very important that people understand what this is about. This message in The Matrix and Terminator is the message of God, and it needs to go around the entire world, which it has. Now, those people who stole it are not godly people.
Mm-hmm.
They're greedy people because they have the money to pay for it. What kind of people do you have the money to pay for something and they steal because they want to own the whole pie? They want to own the whole copyrights. You know what I'm talking about?
Absolutely.
The reason why they've been paying off and keeping you guys in the loop, pull the Milli Vanilli and a Houdini on you guys, is because when the truth comes out about them, like Harvey Weinstein and Steve Wynn, like here in Vegas, because I live in Vegas, Las Vegas, Nevada. And as soon as the misconduct on Steve Wynn came out, his company took a $3 billion hit. And so that's what's going to happen to Warner Brothers and 20th Century Fox and James Cameron and Gail Ann Hurd and Andy and Larry Wachowski and Joel Silvers when the people find out they're nothing but thieves and liars, that they never wrote anything, that they never entered any documents into the court system at all. Can you believe that? They have assignments because you don't want to commit fraud on the government. Because if you put in anything into a government agency, you are swearing under oath and you will be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law. So people are talking about, well, James Cameron came up with the characters and the Terminator. He did not. He lied. That's why you don't see none of them on mainstream television doing any interviews. The only person that God's allows to interview is me, because I'm the real creator and owner of the work and the franchises. Every time they take a royalty, a dollar, or any royalty money, it stretches out the statutes of limitations for prosecution another 10 years. You can be 75 years old or 65 years old, like Bernie Madoff, going to jail. He was stealing for 20 to 30 years. And he went to prison at 65 years old. He got 150 years. Al Capone, he died in prison of syphilis. John Gotti, he died in prison from cancer. They got Whitey Bulger. He was on the run for 20, 25 years. They got him. What people don't understand, the Wall Street wolves, they got them. They threw money at the FBI. You saw Leonardo DiCaprio playing the main thief role, and he's throwing money at the FBI because they don't have any respect for law enforcement. They don't have any respect for the Department of Justice or the FBI, because just like in the Untouchables, you guys are familiar with the Untouchables. That's RICO. That's racketeering. And they had to create a new law for these people because they steal hundreds of millions and billions of dollars, and they pay to stay out of jail. They pay senators. They pay FBI directors. They pay on another level the police commissioners. They pay all these people. They sell their souls for money to thwart justice. But it still catches up with you. It doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter if you're 65 or 70 years old going to jail. It's just a little harder for you in prison when you get older.
Absolutely. In this process of how did you find out that, I know you found out March 31st that, you know, they had stolen. How did they get it? How did they get access to your script?
Well, I was not shopping my work with the lies on the end of windows on the Matrix. I mean, on the internet, talking about the Matrix and Terminator. I was not shopping my work. I saw Star Wars in the late 70s, 1977, New Yorker. I'm at the Apollo Theater and I'm seeing this new movie. And then I see the screen credit, and it's talking about George Lucas as the director. Now, I didn't know that George Lucas had written Star Wars, and he was the owner and the creator of it. All I saw was he was the director, and I wrote my work while I was at USC Film School. That's what you go there to film school, is to create. They're talking about me in the news, that Sophia Stewart, the Los Angeles Sentinel, go and look this up. It's archived. Anybody want to see the real truth and want to see something about me in media, will go into their library and look in the archives. Sophia Stewart, pull up the interview. There I am in 1981. They're talking about me, Los Angeles Sentinel, that I'm going to come out with the first Black superhero movie, first of its kind, never been before ever seen on the screen. So our kids can inspire to become anything they want to, including President of the United States. And I know my work, Matrix and Terminator, is what helped to get Obama elected and accepted, because the Neo character was based on my friend and also a man I was engaged to marry in 1980, Muhammad Ali. And the dedications is in my third eye book. And no one ever had brought that up. We had a living, he's passed away now, the late Muhammad Ali, but
Who were you engaged? And that's fascinating. How did you meet Muhammad Ali? And walk us through that. That's an amazing story.
Yeah, it's a very amazing story. I met him through one of his bodyguards named Abdullah. I used to go to the Lakers games all the time. I had a lot of friends on the Lakers, Jim Chong, Norm Nixon, and Cooper, and all those guys. And they, of course, introduced me to Magic Johnson. But I had a lot of Laker friends. They knew I was, you know, a West Coast correspondent from National Magazine out from New York City. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they love courting the media, you know, especially someone that's going to interview them or do a spot on them. So they used to leave tickets for me at the box office all the time, and I'd come and pick them up, and I'd, you know, and then I would meet a lot of people after the game was over, because we'd go into, you know, it was out there in Inglewood Forum, and they had a nice bar and everything where people come and they would talk, and a lot of the players would come in and introduce you to other players that would be in, you know, in town. And so that's where I met Abdullah, and Abdullah told Muhammad Ali about me. And to make a long story short, Muhammad Ali called me personally just from Abdullah talking about me and asked me to go out with him, asked to come pick me up. And of course, I told him, no, I'll meet you someplace. And he said, you don't want me to come and pick you up? He couldn't believe that, because he said no one had ever said no to him. Ever, you know, and I didn't know that. I mean, you know, I'm very, very young, way younger than he, and he was 38, and I thought that was old. I was like, you know, I could meet you, and of course, he said the speakeasy, and this was a club up in Hollywood, and of course, me and my girlfriend, Marilyn Scott, we went up there and met him, and that's where everything started right there.
How old were you at the time?
Well, I'm not going to tell my age, because it's always identity theft here. But my birthday, there is a birthday that I celebrate that's online for all my fans. But you know, we live in a technical world where anybody can use anything to get anything they want, and that you're setting yourself up for a lot of problems when you reveal a lot of information on media or to the media. You're putting it on the airwaves. And you got to realize I'm a paralegal, and also I come from law enforcement family.
Fair enough. So finish up with Ali. Now, you guys obviously fell in love. You got engaged. How to walk us through that.
Well,
then we'll get back to the main story. But this is great, because we love, you know, Muhammad Ali and how he inspired the role that he kind of played in all of this. This is amazing.
Well,
he's our first Black superhero for many of us.
Well, he is our first Black superhero, but he's a living super Black hero. And no one had acknowledged that until I acknowledged it in my writing. He saw my writings and he was just amazed. In fact, he had my writings framed in his mansion. You know, people would come, you know, to his mansion. They would see my writing. He said, you know, your writing is framed in his house. I said, of course I know. You know, he introduced me to directors. He introduced me to a lot of important business people. We were often photographed in the media. So all this can be pulled up from the archives. He introduced me to Magic also, Magic Johnson, and a lot of celebrities. Leon.
You used to hang out with Michael Jackson and Lionel Richie.
Yeah, because the Jacksons are the ones who discovered me. I've known the Jacksons since 1980. And I'm still friends with them right now. I see them often. And Joe Jackson, he lives here. We did the red carpet together, the 2013 Academy Awards. And he told the media that the Jacksons are the ones who discovered me. I first did Janet Jackson's first television feature film when she was a teenager in the 80s.
Wow.
Before she became a superstar. I was going to her concert in LaToya because Joe was managing them, and he intended to blow them up right after he blew the boys up. So that's where, and Lionel Richie, of course, I go back with the late Don Cornelius, who was a very good friend of mine. Dick Barnett, the New York Knicks, Dick Barnett was a very good friend of mine. He sent a letter of recommendations to Don Cornelius telling him that I was going to be going to film school to take care of me. And Don was just exceptional. He invited me to Soul Train, all the private parties, and I met a lot of people through him. So I was already in the media, already doing things. I didn't just pop up out of nowhere. I had credentials.
You were in the industry very, very, very well established in the industry.
Right. I even was in movies. My first movies was with James Earl Jones. I know him. Richard Larson. He's a good friend of mine who's married to Beyonce's mother. I played his girlfriend in the movie Golden Moments, where the late Ed McMahon was in. Brian Keith's son was also. I know him. And I know these people. And I was in another movie called The Competition with Richard Dreyfuss. I was in another movie called The Hunter with John Savage. So, and of course, I knew Roger Mosley and the late Ron O'Neill, who played Superfly. All these people I were hanging around. Lionel Richie's daughter, his biological daughter, because he has a biological daughter named Sophia. She was going with Justin Bieber for a moment. She's 18 or 19 years old. Well, that's my namesake, Sophia. Because he's a very good friend of mine, Lionel Richie, and that's why you saw the pictures. But he introduced me to everybody over at Motown. The Commodores brought me into the Motown family.
Wow. Wow. So now this is absolutely fascinating. So let's go back to as they call him, the GOAT, the greatest of all times. Let's go back to Muhammad Ali. How did you fall in love with Muhammad Ali? I mean, I can't say love at first sight, but I mean, you know, it's Muhammad Ali, for crying out loud.
It wasn't love at first sight for me, but it was love at first sight for him. Because you got to realize a man of his stature had never been said no to. And, you know, that can crack any male's ego. I'm sorry, whether you're famous or not. They're not used to the word no, and that makes them want to marry you because they're interested in somebody that's really interested in themselves, you know, because it's about principles and things. And I told him that I didn't have those feelings for him. I just was truthful. You know what I'm talking about? And that interested him, and he gave me his private number, and we became friends first. And he got to see what kind of person I am. And he loved the fact that I was educated. He loved the fact that I was talented. And so this is why when you see in the media,
he did not treat you, and this is very important, he didn't treat you like a groupie. He treated you with the utmost respect. So he knew you had a brain as well as beauty, but he respected that and saw that and admired that in you.
Yes, indeed.
Very fantastic.
Much. In fact, there's lots of people, celebrities and other people who work for him can attest to this. There's bodyguards that will tell you the treatment that he gave me and the respect. It's well recorded because I was on his arms in the media with him, and he and Veronica's relationship was physically out at that point. And he was going to marry me in a Muslim ceremony first because that's what they do. He introduced me to the imam, and of course, March Thomas, his secretary, and Abdel, his valet, and one of his bodyguards, James. I know these people more personally, but there were others. He had like 8 bodyguards and stuff. But Abdel and James, I knew personally, those two. The other ones, they were just there. I didn't intermingle with them. But Boudini Brown, I knew him. And of course, the late Howard Bingham. And of course, Boudini Brown is dead too also. Mm-hmm. But it was, you know, this is why the people who stole my work knew this. They knew everything about me because on my copyrights was my address, that I came from the Bronx in Riverdale, New York. Riverdale is a section of the Bronx, you know, 231st and Broadway, you know what I'm talking about. So they investigated and they knew everything about me because you got to realize my name and address is on the copyrights. So they've already read about me because I'm in the media and I've done media, worked for media. So they knew that my connections with Muhammad Ali, they knew that the work was inspired by he and God, because it's metaphysical work. Mm-hmm. Metaphysical work meaning where you join spirituality with science.
Mm-hmm.
That's metaphysics.
Mm-hmm.
And these are going to be the first metaphysics work done in science fiction form, but talking spiritually about God and about man and man's relationship to God. And God wanting them to know him better.
Were you always metaphysical? Were you introduced to the to metaphysics as a child early on? Or was that just something that was in you?
It was something that was in me, but I studied all religions when I was in school and college at the university, City University of New York, and of course, USC. But it was always in me. I knew that no one had ever done metaphysical movies, and this would be the first, but it would give people a sense of the knowledge of God and their connections to God, and their, you know, and it would raise awareness of what was going on in the world that they live in, which is the womb, the matrix.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So this is what, why the, it was all born in me, but this is why they wanted Will Smith to play Neo. It wasn't because he was black, because people always get confused with that. But they knew about Muhammad Ali. And do you remember Will played in the movie Ali, Will mm-hmm. played Muhammad Ali.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Because people don't realize that connection.
Wow.
Just thinking that Will is black and that's why they wanted him, the thieves, to play him. But it wasn't that. It was the connection to the late Muhammad Ali.
Wow.
You
were the first to write about a black superhero, and that black superhero was Muhammad Ali. He was the one. He was Neo.
And this is, see, like the Black Panther movie.
Yeah.
The Black Panther movie is the first African black superheroes. Because, see, Africa has never had a superhero.
Mm-hmm.
America, we've already had the black superhero, the Matrix. That's why the Matrix was so huge and why it affected the whole entire world.
Yes. Because
Muhammad Ali was global, international, a superhero for all people because he stood up for the truth, which is amazing. Most people would have not had the courage.
Mm-hmm.
Would have been a fearful. They would have feared for their lives or their families. They just wouldn't have stood up for God and truth. So that's why Matrix is a brand and why it made billions of dollars and why it affected the whole entire world. In fact, Matrix and Terminator has a more global effect on the international countries than the Americans.
Is that right?
80 million people in America, 7 billion people on the earth. But the greatest impact was in the foreign countries who really understood what I wrote and understood what happened to me.
And that's probably why you have like a quarter of a billion fans worldwide.
Yes, I got 250 million fans following me globally. They love me. It's amazing. Because I gave them these heroes, I gave them these characters, I gave them this metaphysical work that they can identify in their lives, and it has awakened them, it has healed them, it has brought them out of, you know, sleep and to
consciousness. We're going to get into a little bit more into the lawsuit or whatever, but this is absolutely fascinating. And I remember, you know, because of the success of Black Panther, I remember someone on one of the, because we did one of the first reviews on Black Panther, and someone said, well, you know, this is only a movie. Let's just not, you know, take it too seriously and literally. Well, that's a problem for me because movies and the arts, you know how they say art imitates life, is radically important. If movies weren't important, you and I wouldn't be having this conversation right now, right? You would not have infected, if you will, positively, the entire planet. So movies and messages in movies are radically important. Would you agree?
I agree totally, because people don't realize the subliminal messages that are put in movies. They have no clue that they are affected by these movies, or maybe infected by these movies, you know, might be a better word.
That's what I said, yeah.
It's absolutely the truth, you know, but these movies have a far reaching impact on these people in their lives. They have all these subliminal messages in there, and these messages are going straight to your brain because people don't even understand how the commercial works. Mm-hmm. You know, I studied all this in school, how to make films, how to make commercials, you know, how to make movies, you know, television features and so forth. So a lot of people don't know that they're being influenced by all of the airwaves. When God told us in the Bible that the devil is an Ebonic word for the evil, not somebody with some gloves and horn on their heads and all of this mess. No, the devil or the evil, if you take the word the, D-A-G, or the, you know, D as in David, it's nothing but an Ebonic word for the evil, because look, D-E-V-I-L, you know, the evil. So who is the devil that perpetrates evil on others? Is man. Man is the devil that enslaves his own kind. And how does he enslave him, his own kind? And God says that he was the king of the airwaves. And what is the airwaves? What is media? It's magazine, newspaper, television, radio, you know, Wi-Fi, internet.
Oh, looks like another phone call is coming in. Our phone is ringing. So yeah, we lost our video.
I'm sorry about that. You know,
No problem. You'll be back in a moment, I'm sure. So after it finishes ringing.
Well, I get millions of calls, so this is God working, because two is, that's amazing compared to what I really get. But I did tell a lot of people not to call me, that I was going to be doing interviews today at 11 o'clock. But you can't stop people or business, because right now a lot of people are trying to get the Matrix 4 movie. They're looking at that $500 million or over $500 million that Black Panther have made. And they're sizzling for Matrix 4, the fourth installment of Matrix.
Can we see if we can get your camera back, Sophia? I don't know if David is there, that he can maybe push a button or two or something and figure that out.
Yeah, you did something.
What happened? Hang on. Oh, I know what happened. Hold on.
Okay.
Just hold on. Okay. He thinks. Just one moment.
Yep.
Okay. I'm going to make it go back. Yeah, can you flip it back around? It's the camera. It holds up.
Right here.
Yeah. It's you. Okay. Yeah.
This is live technology, family. This is an Apple phone to a computer.
Yeah, okay.
This is crazy. I love it.
The next time, I'm going to have to do it on my Apple iPad.
Absolutely, no problem.
Because I could have put the app on there and, you know, use that, because that's bigger, that's better.
Sure.
You know, but I wasn't thinking, I was only thinking about what you say, following the link.
And this is, they're right. This is obviously your first Google Hangout, so I'm honored for that, to be able to say that.
I always do other ones. I do Viber.
Yep, you do Skype and all of that. Yep.
Other types of media and live media and, you know, cameras and, but, you know, because I just had an interview yesterday and it was live and all that stuff, but they were filming it. So, you know,
welcome to Google and welcome to YouTube, Sophia Stewart. So now let's talk about, as we go into them trying to make the Matrix 4, because obviously Black Panther, huge numbers, completely breaking the myth that Black folk don't go and see and support films domestically here in the States and worldwide. However, you own, obviously, at the copyrights, and you are due a huge financial payment from this. How where walk us through where you left off with the courts and the bad judges and the bad lawyers, and move us up to where we are right now.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because People need to know that I won the lawsuit 4 years ago.
Yeah.
One in Utah, and the court case was only 7 years. There's this smear out talking about I'm in the 70s and I'm unemployed at home and it took me 30 years to win. I don't know where they get this garbage from, because nobody has ever in life been in a court case for no 30 years, nowhere on earth. If you don't believe me, Ripley's Believe It or Not, look it up, or the World Book of Guinness, it'll tell you the longest court cases, and no one 30 years. There is no court case that would even have a court case, because it's a discrimination. It violated your right to due process if it lasts 30 years, okay? The judges and everybody would be dead probably, old by that time.
True. So
I need to clear up this point. This mythology, this urban legend, these smears.
Yeah.
It only took 7 years. It only took 7 years. Listen, everybody, 7 years from 2007 to September 25th, 2014. The first court case was less than a year, wasn't even a year. It was just a dismissal. In any case, I don't care what case you have, what type of case it is, if you don't enter any evidence in, that case is going to get dismissed. And my attorneys had the evidence, and they admitted it, and they failed to put it in. So the judge, the second judge on the case, had to dismiss it. Now, the first judge, the late Johnny Conklin, came to do my case. He called me for my case, and unfortunately, he died before he could do it.
Mm.
Now, that was horrible. So, but it was okay. They knew I filed a RICO because the government was supposed to prosecute these people. And they were supposed to put them in jail, because when somebody bootleg and counterfeits your copyright, it makes all of you guys' copyrights out there worthless. It's just mm-hmm. like somebody counterfeiting $100 into $1,000. Well, it made even the agents make everybody's money worthless. So right now, this case affects you. Until the government come and prosecute these thieves, your copyrights are worthless.
That's a good point, because there are a lot of young, up-and-coming screenwriters, and not even just in movies, but music as well, in the arts. And you're right, you know, how do they protect themselves? If it can happen to you, my gosh, it can happen to anyone. So this is more than just it's a movement. It's more than just a lawsuit.
Well, it did happen to everyone. These thieves have stolen from numerous of people, whether it's televised, advertised, or mentioned anywhere. A lot of people could not fight these giants. Like, I'm David, you know, the Bible, David the Goliath, but
right.
David fought more than one giant. You know, he killed Goliath, but he also fought many giants. He also fought some lions and some bears and some wolves before he even fought Goliath.
So sure. What gave you that? Where does that fortitude come from? I know you come from a military family background, but what gave you that fight? Because a lot of people would have given up and would have been intimidated and would have went away.
I grew up as a female jock. I was very competitive. I won the presidential award. I was doing every sport you can imagine. I was in college. I played tennis with the boys. My brother gave me a male orientation. He taught me to drive when I was 9 years old on the freeway and speeding. And I learned from a stick. And he taught me to play football. I was a running back. Because I was the smallest one, they had to protect me, so I had the ball. He taught me to wrestle, to fix cars. So I knew everything about cars, because he was going to teach me how to change out engines. Because that's what my brother was doing, because I was with my brothers. I was playing hardball, baseball. I was playing track, running track, batman, archery, every kind of basketball, volleyball. I was playing basketball with the high school teams and volleyball, because I was just a female competitive jock. And you know what that's like. That's driven. You mm-hmm. got to win. You want to win. And you have the discipline to win. And of course, it started out early, so this is all instilled in me. Plus, my grandmother instilled wisdom and spirituality and the knowledge of God You know what I'm talking about? I had all of these things and all this fortitude to make sure that I would succeed. And no matter what I did, I would succeed.
Well, you definitely succeeded. So when did
wildest dreams have I succeeded?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
It's so true.
So in that 7 year period, what did you have to go through and grow through in that 7 year period to get to the point where they finally said, yeah, you are the copyright owner. What was it, 81, 80?
81, 82,
82,
and
83,
and
84.
83, 81,
83, and 84, yeah.
Are my copyrights.
Yeah.
Now, what did I go through? I didn't go through anything because, like I said, the first judge on that case was Terry Hatter Jr. The late Johnny Cochran told me, have her bend over backwards to make sure I get justice. This is a California case, and I'm going to go into the Utah.
Okay, yeah, because I want to know how it goes from California to Utah and why Utah. We talked about that in the green room. Go ahead.
Yeah, but it needs to get these facts in.
Sure.
Johnny Cochran and the judge, and why they sabotaged the case, and why they tried to sabotage the second case. Well, it's because of the judges that are on the case. That's why I brought it up. Terry Hatter Jr. was with Martin Luther King during the Civil Rights era. And so the late Johnny Cochran told me he'd bend over backwards to make sure I got justice. So they needed to get him off of the case. They got him off the case by hiring his son to defend them. The judge's son is an attorney. They paid him but never used him. They just wanted to get rid of the judge. I'm bringing this criminal aspect in, because I want you to see the criminal aspect in the second court case.
Okay, we lost your video again, so I want to make sure that's coming back so that you can explain that. So let's try to get your video back again, Sophia and David.
If there was any way I could block those calls, I would block them, but they haven't put that on a cell phone yet. Maybe I urge them to do it now that I mention it. Is there some way you could just block all phone calls until afterwards? But anyway, like I was saying, some of the, like, Skype and Viber won't even allow the phone calls to interfere. So Google Hangout needs to catch up. That's a Google.
Well, Google is still running. It's not Google.
Google know that's a Google.
It's Apple. Apple is the problem.
I'm on Viber and I'm on some of the other apps. Guess what? No matter how many calls you get, can't interfere, you know. But anyway, let me go back to the legal issues. They got that judge off. They did the same thing in Utah. There was this good judge on the case. His name was Judge Dale Kimball. They got him off. They put their own Clark Waddle off and Brooke C. Wells. Now, let me tell you what I did to get them off. God told me to write in a legal brief and call the judge a cheap prostitute who sold her soul for money. And he told me to call the judge a grandmaster Ku Klux Klansman. Well, when I wrote that in the legal brief, because they were trying to fix the case in Utah. Well, when I wrote that in the legal brief, guess what? They recused themselves off of my case in a New York minute.
Wow.
Then the new judges came on. D. Benson and Evelyn J. First. And the FBI agents had nothing but admirations for Evelyn J. First, a magistrate judge. So these were the two judges, because I had to have another judge, David Nerfer, to court order my lawyers also I could come on and take over the case. So the case went for 7 years, but I was working it for almost 4 years on my own. I was working it from December the 7th, 2011, up until I won September the 25th, 2014.
Wow.
And I was doing the trademark case at the same time. Now, granted, I've never studied trademark law or intellectual law, but I beat all of their lawyers in both court cases. And they got lawyers that get paid $2,000 to $3,000 an hour. I bet you that shocked you.
Yeah, I'm shocked. But that's my middle name and acronym, shocked. So that's a good thing. Now, I remember when we talked, we talked for so many times, but I think it was the first time I talked to you back in 2015. you told me something about, and I think this was before September 25th. You told me something about there was some hearing or something happened where these guys didn't show up, because if they had have shown up, they would have went straight to prison.
That's right. They had put those lies and smears and innuendos on the internet that I never showed up for my California court case. Well, you know, God turned everything back around on them. The lies they told on me, God turned it around, and they actually committed the lies that they told on me. I was prevented from going to any hearings in California. I was prevented from doing depositions. They canceled all my depositions, all of them. I was prevented from going under oath or speaking under oath in the courtroom. I never got to step outside of Utah, because I was living in Utah, like I said, because I was visiting my brothers who stationed there at Hill Air Force Base military. And so I never got to do anything in California. And they were trying, when I filed the lawsuit in Utah, they were trying to get the case changed over to California so it could get dismissed and thrown out permanently. Because you only got 1 year to file in California after a dismissal. And that had already ran its course since 2006. So when I filed in 2007, I'm saying that Utah has jurisdiction over the case, because Utah has 3 years to refile a case. Their statute of limitations is 3 years. So my attorneys, they were white, and the ones that sabotaged me in California, they were white, except for one was half white and half black. He's the one that told on them that they were that Warner Brothers had paid all of them to sabotage my case in California. Now, the FBI should have arrested them, because there was a witness. He gave testimony to it. Now, let's go back to Utah. They were telling the judge, Judge Dale Kimball, you know, California has jurisdiction, Utah has no jurisdiction. So my white attorneys, they were not prolific enough to win that. So they turned it over to me. They say, Sophia, we have to turn this over to you. We cannot come up with an answer to win it, to get it to stay in Utah. I say, well, I can. Everything is just the opposite of what somebody does. Mm-hmm. If somebody's lying on you, all you got to do is tell the truth. If somebody is persecuting you, all you got to do is pray for them. If someone is treating you bad, all you got to do is kill them with kindness. So what did I do? I wrote up a legal brief telling the judge that nothing ever happened in California. That I never, see, what they did to sabotage me flipped back around on them. Since I never stepped out of California, I was in Utah, then I told the judge all the action took place in Utah. I paid them $50,000 cashier's check off of Utah's bank. I told them they called me for conferences and meetings in Utah. They signed a contract with me and Utah. You know, everything was done in Utah. So the judge came back on his ruling and denied them and said, Utah has jurisdiction and we're going to hear this court case.
Wow.
That was my first victory. And how did I win? Let me tell you how I won. When they saw that the four lawyers couldn't beat me, that, you know what I'm saying? Four law firms couldn't beat me in Utah. I'm winning the court case in Utah. Warner Brothers, all of the defendants from the California case, they boldly stepped into the Utah case and asked the judges for the default judgment and the money that they never received in California. Over 300 some thousand, almost $500,000 in attorney fees. They never received it, because if you look at the California transcript, they were all terminated out of the case because they were scared they were going to go to jail before the RICO case could get dismissed. And the one that was half black and half white.
That was this document right here, if I remember. Is that right?
That's the one. The judge right there. That was the money they were asking for. They needed the judgment and they needed the money. That's why they entered on their own volition. They entered the court case. But guess what? They made one fatal mistake. Do you know what the fatal mistake was that they made?
What was that?
They entered through the judge's law firm called Snow Montanuk. When you enter in through a judge's law firm, you have paid off the judge to fix the case. Mm-hmm. I wrote a legal brief and told the judge if he gave them the default judgment and the money, he was going to go to jail with them.
Wow.
And in his law firm. Now, think about how arrogant and ignorant these people are. You can buy Warner Brothers and 20th Century Fox or billion-dollar corporations. They can buy 100 or maybe 200 law firms in Utah, Salt Lake City, Utah. So why do you need to enter the judge's law firm when you can buy any law firm in Utah and enter into the court system? They thought I wouldn't know. I'm the oracle. They thought I would not know this information. You see what I'm talking about?
You know, I am blown away by, I'm always blown away when I'm having conversations with you, but I'm really blown away by the greed, the arrogance, the mindset, the ignorance of these of these billionaires and these corporations.
Well, that are running these corporations are greedy. You know, the common people steal because they're needy. They may need some food. They may need something to drink. They might even need some drugs because they don't have any money. But it's a crime for the corporations who get, they have billions of dollars they can buy. Why do they need to be greedy and steal from the people? We had great diversity in movies when they bought the people's scripts and stories and treatments and stuff. Think about this. When back in the 50s and 60s and 70s, go back, any of you, go back on YouTube and look at all the great movies we had. That was when the studios was buying the movies. Then all of a sudden somebody got clever and said, what do we need to buy when we can steal and subvert these people and steal their intellectual properties? And they didn't care if it was copyrighted because we could pay off law enforcement. We could pay off judges. We're corporations that are worth billions of dollars. We can pay off anybody except for God.
We can pay off
everybody except for God and truth.
And the oracle, you.
Well, I stood for truth. Yeah. Laughing.
Now, so now, let me ask you this. Obviously it's greed, but do you think there was like racial bias or gender bias as a result of how they treated you? Does that play into this?
It was a mixture of everything, racial discrimination, me being a woman, you know, a number of things. But the biggest issue that you're failing to look at, it was the government discriminating against me. Criminals, because criminals, they're going to do any and everything. Sometimes a criminal ain't even thinking about discrimination. Sometimes a criminal is not even thinking about a right issue or a wrong issue.
Wow.
What a criminal is thinking about is greed and how much money they're going to get. But the government knows better. The government is the one that's at fault here. Why did I even have to go to court? You should ask yourself that question. But it was criminal. It was a criminal matter. Look, you go to the police department. Somebody stole your car. And then you go to the police department and you tell the police department. They investigate. They find evidence, but they don't prosecute. And they tell you to go to court? Don't that sound kind of screwy to you? Don't that sound like something is wrong with people?
Yeah, something's wrong with the system, obviously, yes.
Exactly, because it's a criminal matter. What can a person do against a criminal matter? You have to do the best that you can. Because people ask me this question every day. I've done over 4,000 media interviews. International media, Wall Street Journal, 2009, Coast to Coast, John B. Wells, Essence, Vibe, Source, Black Enterprise, you name it, I've done it. But come on, what is the real issue here? What is going on with our system when they tell people who's gotten their copyright stolen, who've gotten their work stolen, who's gotten things stolen, tell them to go up against these billion-dollar corporations. Mm-hmm. You know, but when you download 10 copies of Deadpool, a 25-year-old boy, I think he's 25, and he's in his 20s, he downloads 10 copies and the FBI come out and arrest him. So wait a minute. You're going to protect the studios, but you're not going to protect the people? You're going to tell the people to go to court and take against billion-dollar corporations that don't, they can't even fathom that? They're no way prepared for that? Yet you go out and protect the corporations worth billions and you don't tell them to go to court? Because the thieves are not going to file a lawsuit against you. Guess what? The thief is not going to file a lawsuit because there's magistrate judges on the bench. So if the thieves walk into the courtroom, they're going to jail. That's the issue you asked me for.
Yes.
Why did they not show up in Utah? When the judge asked for the defendants, I told the judge they're not here and they're not coming because if they do, they're going to be arrested because there's 4 to 5 FBI agents and marshals with guns on in the courtroom waiting on them. And their lawyers are going to be arrested with them because they're their mouthpieces. You tell me they're going to walk up in there?
No.
The only smears and lies and innuendo is from the trolls that get paid on the internet or ignorant people who don't believe the system. Warner Brothers, Fox, James Cameron, Gail Ann Hurd, Andy Larry Wachowski, and Joel Silvers have never called me a liar, have never said on any talk shows, not including yours, that they own The Matrix and Terminator. Because you know why? It's a deposition, it's on tape, and I can use that against them in any court of law to get them arrested.
So,
perjury and fraud on tape.
No question about it. So now here we are with which one came first? Was it, well, the third eye book came first, and then you wrote Matrix 4, the evolution, cracking the genetic code.
Yeah, because Matrix 4 is a continuation of the Matrix, the continuation of the work. Because if you look at 2 and 3, these thieves are trying to steal it and change the concept, trying to change the whole storyline and go in another direction, and it flopped. So what do? They kill out the characters. Well, go back to King Solomon and the two ladies fighting over the baby. Excuse me, and King Solomon said he's going to cut the baby in half. And the mother said, no, I don't want my baby to die. Just give it to her. And she was like, no, kill the baby. The thief was, kill the baby. And Solomon says, I know who the thief is now. It's you that want the baby dead. Take her out and hang her. Now, ask the people what is wrong with them. Why would you kill something that's making billions of dollars? And why would you fix something if it's nothing wrong with it, and it's making the kind of money you want it to make, and that I'm the owner, the creator, and you can't kill my work. So what do? I come in and I make 2 and 3 a dream because I wrote The Second Coming of the Christ, The Evolutions of Consciousness, Man versus the Machines. So all I had to do was make it a dream that Neo and Trinity shared. They wake up, and from the dream, and the saga of the Matrix continued. Well, greater graphics, greater storyline, new special effects, and new machines to take the agents, the old agents program place. That's how what Matrix is, a continuation of the new. Not like Star Wars, where you still got the same ships from 40 some years ago, the same characters, the same. Robotic things haven't gone through evolution yet. But Matrix is steadily evolving. Keanu comes back as Neo. Lawrence Fishburne comes back as Morpheus. Carrie Ann Moss comes back as Trinity. Jada Pickett comes back as Niobe.
How has the Matrix family, because it's very difficult because obviously they can't say anything publicly because of their incomes and lives, but they obviously love you and support you. You have photos with all of them and the cast and what have you. How is the relationship with the Matrix cast? How is your relationship with the Matrix cast with Fishburne and...
If everybody knows that I wrote The Matrix and Terminator, that is not a hidden secret in Hollywood. The only people that's fooled are the masses, as usual. That's the only people that get harvest is the masses. That's the only people that you have to fool, because that's the people with the power. You know what John Kennedy said? That the power has always been with the people, and then once you wake up the people, hey, well, you done made a big mistake. Because they might want kings and presidents to rule over them, but when they get angry, like the little angry bees, they finally wake up and understand that they got the power to change anything they do not like. As you can see what's going on right now with the Black Panther movie. That was lied, that Black people had no unity, that Black people never supported Black anything. In fact, Hollywood lied and told people for years, when Black people and people of color kept asking, why don't we have Black movies? Well, Hollywood told you guys this lie for years, that, Black movies don't make any money. We don't want to put any Black movies in because they were sabotaging the movies. They purposely make sure that they were not advertised or marketed. They would make sure that by the time Black people got around to seeing the movie, it was going out of the theaters. Was already on DVD. They would do some of the most salacious, evil things to people of color. I have to say people of color, because the multitude of the race, 3/4 of the race of the world, are nothing but people of color, and they're Black. Whether they lie to these people in America so they can get some allies, everybody in their third world countries know they're Black. Everybody in these other countries know they're Black. When you go to, because I come from military. I come from military. Families all stationed all over the world seeing these people of color in Black.
Yep.
The only time they lie to you, they tell the Mexicans in America that you're white. They tell the natives here, you're white. They tell the Italians, the Sicilians, you're white. They tell the French people, you're white. They tell the Canadians, you're white. They're telling and lying to everybody because they're the minorities. How in the hell can 3/4 of the world be minorities when we're the majorities?
Come on with it now,
Sophia. I'd like to find that out mathematically.
I love you.
Well, I'm white. Telling the truth.
Yeah, you're absolutely telling the truth. Yeah, so what do you think this new awareness, particularly for this generation, what do you think the awareness of Black Panther and Black empowerment and the truth being blatantly told and shown, what do you think that says to the white supremacist minority?
Well, they're dumbing down the kids in the school. They're trying to change the history again. And everybody, that baby boomers know the truth because they were there. They witnessed and saw the actual truth of history being made. Now, after the baby boomers died, there may be some problems here if the truth is not passed down through the DNA and through word of mouth to the children. Now, as far as the Black Panther goes, the Black Panther is based on a real true story. And you know this true story from the 60s and the 70s, because we had the living Black Panther heroes here in America, Black power. More power to the people.
Absolutely.
Angela Davis, Bobby Seale, you know, the Kathleen Kennedy and her husband, Eldridge Cleaver. Come on, people. They started the free lunch programs. They did many things. My brothers and sisters, they were older than me, and they were still teenagers at that time. So they got a little taste during the Vietnam War. This is what the Black Panther really stands for. The Black Panther heroes of America that got slaughtered because they wanted some power. They wanted to correct things. And everybody else, like the late Congressman Lewis, mm-hmm. Bending with the Wind. He told how the whites came in and bought out Martin Luther King Foundation with millions. The NAACP was bought out, Jesse Jackson, and not long ago, Al Sharpton. And of course, Louis Farrakhan. Sorry, Muslims. It's the truth. He's talking about you, Congressman John Lewis, because he's got the facts. He's got things. It's not Sophia Stewart saying this, but Congressman John Lewis, read his book.
Mm-hmm.
He told everybody the truth. It's just this. The red or the blue pill. You can take the red pill and see how deep the rabbit hole goes and dig for truth and dig for more truth. Or you can take the blue pill like Cypher, my character Cypher in The Matrix. You know you're not eating a steak, you're eating mush. You can go to sleep and continue the lie because God gave you free will and choice. I'm not trying to take your choice. I'm like Kanye West's song. I'm not here to turn atheists into believers. I'm not here to lead you someplace like the cults do, cult religions and cults around the world. I'm only here to tell you the truth. You can accept it or not. That's fine, because even God doesn't take your free will from you.
Mm-hmm.
I understand that. Truth is something that you got to deal with before you leave this earth, you. Because what you do don't affect me, and what I do don't affect you. Every act that man perpetrates on himself affects him, not others. Trust and believe this. We are all having our own matrix moment here on earth.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's a deep statement, but it's the truth.
Spiritual beings having a human experience, in a sense.
That's right. That's right. And it's nothing but good versus evil going on here. If you look under your car, open up your car hood, you'll see there's only one battery propelling the car. And on that battery are charges. It has a positive charge and it has a negative charge. And what does that tell you? It tells you how the energy flows in that battery. And when it's flowing positively, your car is driving well and smooth. When it's flowing backwards, your car is breaking down and possibly might be burning up. But God says there's only one thing going on here, believe him or not, and that's good.
Mm-hmm.
Evil is taking that good and going in the wrong direction. Mm-hmm. L-I-V-E, live, living. E-V-I-L, the same word, E-V-I-L backwards, an anagram, because it's taking the energy going backwards. That's what evil and sin is. Living a backwards, ignorant life. Ignorance, not a bad word. Look at the word ignorance. It has the word ignore in it because you're ignoring facts you should know.
Wow, and absolutely.
They say, well, it's a political thing, a right thing to say. Well, but politics is a polite lie. I'm mm-hmm. not going to tell you a polite lie. I'm sorry, but that's what politics and when you see politicians, they're telling you some polite lies. Because you already know before they get elected, when they get into the White House, whoever they are, they are puppets. They have a puppeteer that's pulling the strings. Have you ever seen that on television where you see a dummy and the dummy is there and there's somebody of Vinculus is speaking for the dummy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's what's going on in White House. And why do you complain? Because you're the one that voted him in. You're the one that voted everybody in. So what are you complaining about? God told you years ago, many thousands and thousands of years ago, that he would lead you with truth. But they said they wanted a king. They wanted a president. They wanted parliament. They wanted Congress. They wanted representatives. They wanted senators. You know, come on, you asked for it. But God told you that it was you, that man was you. You were infallible. So mm-hmm. then he was going to take your sons and put them in the military and kill them. And he was going to make concubines. Concubines mean whores. Make whores of your daughters. Now he's taking your daughters and putting them in the military and making whores and concubines out of them at the same time.
Mm. Wow.
I'm being real, but it's the truth.
It is the truth.
Don't get an argument with me. All you got to do is go and
research
the facts.
Yeah, look at the facts, absolutely. That being said, where are you now? A lot of people say, well, you know, she should be worth $4 billion now, and have they sent her that check? You know, where are we now with all of this? Because they're talking about they want to make the movie again and another. Can they make another Terminator or Matrix movie?
If they try to make another Matrix and Terminator, it's called consumer fraud. It's just like somebody giving you an Apple Jack instead of an apple.
Mm.
Do you want an Apple Jack when you pay money for an apple? No, I'm asking.
I don't.
Do you want a Gucci arena when you're paying for a Gucci?
No, I do not want a Gucci. I didn't even know there's a Gucci arena. What the hell is that? No, but I know what you're saying. I guess.
That's a fake. Apple Jack is a fake. When you go to buy a brand, when you go to buy the brand, you want the brand. You don't want a fake. You know, because people sell fake out there. You remember that, right?
Absolutely.
And it's called consumer fraud, right? Because you know why it's called consumer fraud? It's consumer fraud because you're paying top dollar for something that you're not getting.
Because
if you're getting a Gucci arena, you're not getting. You're paying $200 or $300. That's what you pay for a Gucci or more. Mm-hmm. Thousands of dollars, depending on what the product that you're buying. But it's hundreds into thousands of dollars. So it's Apple, hundreds into thousands of dollars, depending on what products and stuff you're getting. Well, you want to get the real thing.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to buy something, somebody fool you. So if Zach Penn of Marvel, his Marvel writer, tells you he's going to do a Matrix story with Michael B. Jordan in it, well, you're not getting the Matrix because he can't use Morpheus. He can't make no young Morpheus. He can't use any of my characters or my images or my graphics. But what he's telling you is that Matrix is a generic, just like Matrix Toyota, Matrix Convergence, Matrix Poker. But it doesn't have Neo and Trinity and Morpheus in those images and the numbers rolling down, the logos. That's the Matrix.
Mm.
That's the brand, like Nike, like Apple. He's not selling you that. He's telling you that he's going to give you an inferior. He says, I'm just going to give you a Matrix story. Matrix is a generic, like a cola.
Mm-hmm.
The word Matrix comes from the Bible, 7,000-year-old word. It's a generic, just like cola. I can give you a cola, but I'm not going to give you Coca-Cola, a Pepsi-Cola, or RC-Cola, or Shasta-Cola, because they're brands.
Wow. They have a
formula, and if you copy those formulas, you're going to jail. It's called consumer fraud.
Wow.
If you put the label of Coca-Cola on an inferior product, and it's not the formula of Coca-Cola or Pepsi, you're going to jail because it's called consumer fraud. So when Schwarzenegger tried to give an old 70-year-old man fighting against an old 60-some-year-old woman. It's called Grumpy Terminator, but it's not the Terminator that you saw in the three Terminator movies. This is why 4 and Genesis flopped, because they tried to give you another formula.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Your product, consumer fraud, because they're sitting up there deceiving you, and you're paying for real Terminator money, and you're going to get fake. And I told them if they tried to do that, that I sent them cease and desist letters. And I told all of them and their lawyers that if they come out with that, I would have to file a RICO. Now, they couldn't beat the other RICO. Remember, they sent those lawyers to shut it down?
Mm-hmm.
They were going to go to jail. But now if I file this RICO on them, it would hit the media huge.
Mm-hmm.
And it would show that the government has never done their jobs. Because it's a criminal case. See, I don't have to file copyright anymore because I've already won that.
You already won that, yes.
The franchise. And let me answer your question, everybody out there. Did I get all the money? Money does not make you a billionaire. It's called assets. Owning property, all the billionaires, they own property. right now, if something happened, they would have to collateralize their assets. Collateralize means they would have to turn their assets into money. But I own the Matrix and Terminator franchises. I've been selling it around the world, licensing deals. Mm. What does that tell you, everybody? Mm. It's not about money. Money doesn't make you wealthy. Assets make you wealthy.
Come on now. Wow, we're going to have to do you know you're going to be back because we got to do a series on that just alone.
Right. They were so busy trying to keep the money from me that they forgot about the franchise. Franchises are worth billions of dollars, meaning that I'm worth billions of dollars, meaning I can make licensing deals with China, Russia, Australia, Germany, France, and anybody in the United States. That's what real wealth is.
Wow, love that.
For America.
It's the power of intellectual property. It's something that I've been an advocate of for many years. Talk to them about the power of intellectual property and intellectual assets. That's what you're talking about.
Exactly. This is why a copyright is worth, that's why $4 billion. That's why when Lucas sold to Disney, Disney owns Marvel and Star Wars. Lucas sold it to Disney. They paid him $4 billion in cash for the property. And they're getting their money back because 2016 Star Wars were horrible. Shitty at best. But guess what saved Disney?
Tell us how you really feel about it, Sophia.
$4 in pre-ticket sales is what saved Disney.
$1 billion
in pre-ticket sales. Do you understand what that means? The other one, the Jedi, which came out right after that, horrible. But what saved it? It made $1 billion in pre-ticket sales. Because the fan base, there's a 3 to 4 or 5 billion fans across the world who's going to buy a ticket. You know what I'm talking about?
Absolutely. It's what happened with Black Panther. It was the largest pre-ticket sale movie in history.
Which one?
Black Panther.
Yeah. You know why Black Panther is? Because it's long overdue. A lot of Black Panthers have died. That was the real Black superheroes in America have died. And since these white people have lied to these Black people, telling them that they came from Africa when they were stealing them up north, 12 years a slave, kidnapping them from up north and bringing them to the south, enslaving them, free labor. And Sojourner Truth and Harriet Tubman would come over from the north and steal them back and bring them back to freedom. The story that's never been told. Why do they need to go to Africa to steal Black people when Black people was everywhere?
Already here on this continent as well.
Look, the only two countries that the Black people in America know is Africa and America. I don't know why they don't know about all the other countries and that Black people were in all of these. So why would the whites and the Jews get in their boat and they need to go thousands and thousands of miles to Africa where you may not even make it back and you can't feed everybody because you can barely feed yourself fresh water and food to make it back when they can go up north and steal all the Black people and all the surroundings? Because if you came from Africa, they would have had you on a reservation. You would have been on a reservation just like they do with everybody. When the Pearl Harbor War broke out, the Japanese Americans was fenced in. When the Cubans coming across the water from Cuba, fenced in there, right there, Guantanamo Bay. When all the foreigners, no matter where you come from, you commit a crime, they lock you up. They fence you in. Now, the natives that are mixed with Cortez's blood, they're on Indian reservations. The Mexicans, Cortez, Spaniards, bloodline. They don't tell these people this history that I'm speaking right now. They don't tell people that Black people was all around this whole globe and that there are no races. Africa is not, it's a white man's name and it doesn't designate your skin color.
Right.
It doesn't mean you're Black. It's a place. It's a nation.
Right. Correct.
And I got a white South African in my family. She's a real African, and she's white.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm talking about? But they had lied to the black people, telling them it came from Africa. So it backfired on them. So Marvel is Stan Lee. Who is Stan Lee? He's Jewish.
Mm-hmm.
Whites, Disney, whites. So they come up with the first African superhero. First time that Africa, as long as it's been a continent for thousands of years on the earth, this is the first time they ever got a black superhero. What the hell is that about?
Exactly. Absolutely.
Come on now.
Absolutely.
And all these people they told this lie to, they came out to support their black superheroes. And what is that support? Over $500 billion. It might even be up to $1 billion, but they're scared to say it. You know why they're scared to say it? Because it beat out every one of their white science fiction movies. And right now they're trying to shut down showings of it because the white movies can't even make any money.
The other movies are not making their money back. Wow, that's a good point. I didn't think about that. You're right.
That is a good point.
So it's like everybody's going to see Black Panther, not only once, but I know people have seen the movie 5 times. So as a result of that, why are you going to see, and that's the thing, I don't even know what else is playing.
Yeah, well, that's what they said too. All the people that go in to see Black Panther, they don't even know what else is playing, and they don't care. And guess what? I'm going to see it again myself, and others are going to see it again and again and again. And guess what? It's going to be that every white science fiction that ever existed. Because Matrix is black. I'm sorry. Terminator is black. I'm sorry. And you know how we know? Because it made $100 billion around the world. Three-fourths of the world is black, and they know it.
Wow. I love this. I love you. Thank you so much, Sophia Stewart. And I want to have you come back, and we want to really get deep into the metaphysics of the Matrix and the Terminator. So, that's going to be our next conversation with you. Stick around with me in the green room as I sign off to the family. Family, this is it. We did it. We got Sophia Stewart, affectionately known as the mother of the Matrix, the winner and the owner and the writer and the creator of the Matrix and Terminator franchise. Wow. And you learned about brand. You learned about assets, intellectual property. You got to watch this again and again because this was an education. This was not entertainment. This was education. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to like. I want you to share. I want you to comment. Tell us what you think. We'll see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Take care, everybody.